and Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. And what a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Have we trials and temptations? Is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful? Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer.
Welcome to everyone this morning. Welcome to I can't see many new faces this morning, but welcome anyway, and also welcome to our online congregation, and welcome to anyone who is new to our online congregation. We will have this is our Lent 1 service, so hope you sit back and enjoy. As we gather for worship this morning, we acknowledge the traditional owners of the lands on which we are meeting, and we recognise their special cultural bonds with these lands. We commit to seeking the reconciliation between First and Second Nations peoples of this land, and so we pray for those involved in this process and for Aboriginal elders past, present and emerging. Our call to worship. We thank you, O God, for your Son, Jesus Christ, who strengthens us to stand firm against the devil's temptations, trusting instead in your everlasting saving word and offering our worship and service to you alone. Now, open prayer. Let us pray. God of wilderness and water, your Son was baptized and tempted as we are. Guide us through this season that we may not avoid struggle, but open ourselves to blessing. Through the cleansing depths of repentance and the heavenly words of the Spirit. Amen.
Yes, as Wade said, this is the first Sunday in the period of Lent, 40 days leading up to Easter. So this is just a little bit about Lent itself. Lent is the period of 40 days which comes before Easter in the Christian calendar. Beginning on Ash Wednesday, Lent is a season of reflection and preparation before the celebrations of Easter. By observing the 40 days of Lent, Christians replicate Jesus Christ's sacrifice and withdrawal into the desert for 40 days. Lent is marked by fasting, both from food and activities and festivities, although these days people tend to give up something in particular, such as chocolate or smoking or passion fruit sponge. Not that I eat a lot of passion fruit sponge. But every time a person thinks of having one of these things, they are reminded of Christ's sacrifice at Easter. In early Christianity, it was used to prepare people for baptism and for readmitting into the church those who had left. And in the early church, baptisms were only done on Easter Day, so this was a very important time for the Christian calendar. So Lent is an old English word meaning lengthen. Lent is observed in spring, in the Northern Hemisphere, of course, when the days begin to get longer. And purple is a symbolic colour used in some churches throughout Lent for drapes and altar frontals. Purple is used for two reasons. Firstly, because it is associated with mourning and it anticipates the pain and suffering of the crucifixion. And purple is used secondly because the colour purple is associated with royalty and it celebrates Christ's resurrection and sovereignty. So it's just a little bit about what period we are entering into, what we have entered into. So let us have our prayer of confession. O God, you search us out and know us, and all that we are is open to you. We confess that we are entangled in sin. Be merciful, O Lord, for we have sinned. When we show great discipline in pursuit of worldly wealth, but invest neither energy nor enthusiasm in the treasures of the Spirit, be merciful, O Lord, for we have sinned. When we clamour for your crown, but refuse to shoulder your cross, be merciful, O Lord, for we have sinned. When we confess you amongst our friends, but deny you when your enemies close in, be merciful, O Lord, for we have sinned. When we build our comforts and pleasures on the sacrifice of others, instead of sacrificing our privileges to build a world that all can share in, be merciful, O Lord, for we have sinned. When we look for an easier gospel, a lighter cross, a less demanding saviour, be merciful, O Lord, for we have sinned. This Lent, O Lord, help us to be repentant sinners. We give thanks for your Son, Jesus Christ, whose death on the cross brought us home to you. Let us hear once again Christ's words of grace to us. Your sins are forgiven. You are a forgiven people. Amen.
We're going to light the peace candle now, but also while I'm lighting the peace candle, I'd like us to keep in our heads and minds the people of Ukraine and also the Russian citizens who oppose the war, because I think that there's a lot of Russian citizens that are hopefully not disappearing and not coming back. So I light that for them as well. So now that we have made peace with God, let us, with those around us, let us wish those around us the peace of the Lord, and let us pray for peace to descend on the places of this earth where there is war and injustice. In his precious name, we light the candle. Amen. Thank you. Now, our next hymn this morning is I Heard the Voice of Jesus Say.
Source of all light, by your word you give light to the soul. Pour out on us the spirit of wisdom and understanding, that our hearts and minds may be opened. Amen. And Jimmy's going to lead us in our first reading.
Our first reading is from Romans chapter 10, verses 3 to 13. For being ignorant of the righteousness that comes from God, and seeking to establish their own, they have not submitted to God's righteousness. For Christ is the end of the law, so that there may be righteousness for everyone who believes. Moses writes concerning the righteousness that comes from the law, that the person who does these things will live by them. But the righteousness that comes from faith says, do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven? That is, to bring Christ down. Or who will descend into the abyss? That is, to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you, on your lips and in your heart, that is, the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For one believes with the heart, and so is justified, and one confesses with the mouth, and so is saved. The scripture says, no one believes in him will be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all, and is generous to all who call on him. For everyone calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. For the story is for the founding of our church.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is Luke 4, verses 1 to 13. The temptation of Jesus. Now Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing at all during those days, and when they were over, he was famished. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command the stone to become a loaf of bread." Jesus answered him, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone." Then the devil led him up and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And the devil said to him, "To you I will give their glory and all this authority, for it has been given over to me, and I give it to anyone I please. If you then will worship me, it will all be yours." Jesus answered him, "It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Then the devil took him to Jerusalem and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to protect you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." Jesus answered him, "It is said, do not put the Lord your God to the test." When the devil finished every test, he departed from him until an opportune time. For the good news that Christ brings.
Thanks be to God.
So stand and sing the hymn, Trust and Obey.
When we walk with the Lord in the light of his word, what a glory he sheds on our way. While we do his good will, he abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a burden we bear, not a sorrow we share, but our toil he doth richly repay. Not a grief nor a loss, not a frown or a cross, but is blessed if we trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. What we never can prove, the delights of his love, until all on the altar we lay. For the favor he shows and the joy he bestows are for them who and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Then in fellowship sweet we will sit at His feet, or we'll walk by His side in the way. What He says we will do, where He sends we will go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Well, psychologists and educators like to tell us that each person likes to learn or process things in a different way. Some people like to read about the topic. Some need to take a hands-on approach. Some people like to take their time and mull things over. And some people like me like to make images in their heads. So I had an amazing image this week of Jesus being baptized and coming out of the water. But while as he did so, Satan was sitting under a tree watching it all. Satan was there also when the voice came from heaven, "You are my son, the beloved. With you I am well pleased." And Satan was definitely there when, after his baptism, the Holy Spirit leads Jesus out into the wilderness. Now, out in the wilderness, Jesus fasts for 40 days. He eats nothing. And by the end, as you can imagine, Luke tells us Jesus was famished. Now, I don't eat breakfast, so I haven't eaten since 10 o'clock last night, and I'm starving. We'd never make 40 days. So Jesus was at his physically weakest, and this is when Satan chose to strike. This is true to form for Satan, because he always strives for us to give in to our own temptations when we are at our lowest point, when our resistance is weakest and we are less likely to defy him. Now, we could leave it at that, say something along the lines of, "Be wary of any temptations that come your way," but there is something deeper here. In fact, Satan laying out these temptations before Jesus is really an exploration of who Jesus is. It is an exploration of Jesus' identity, especially his identity as the Son of God, as we heard at his baptism. And Satan opens with the very question, "If you are the Son of God," and then the two enter into what is essentially a debate about using Scripture. There is something deeper still going on here also. There is a massive power struggle. Each time the devil offers a temptation, he is challenging Jesus into conflict with God. So the first temptation, "If you are the Son of God, turn these stones into bread." You've got to remember, Jesus is starving. He has not eaten for 40 days. A bit of bread would be most welcome. But essentially, the challenge is a reminder of the Israelites wandering in the desert for 40 years, and God providing them daily with manna to eat. Satan is asking, "Do you have the power to become God and change these stones into bread, to change the natural order of things?" And Jesus replies, "One does not live by bread alone." The second temptation, worship me and I will give you authority over all the kingdoms of earth. In other words, to have the power of political and military control over all human beings. To which Jesus replies, worship the Lord your God and serve only him. The third temptation, throw yourself down from here because God will command his angels to save you. Why don't you jump from here and force God to protect you? To which Jesus replies, do not put God to the test. Having answered these three temptations without falling to Satan's desires, Satan goes away from him until another time. So the trials are over, and what has Jesus learnt about his identity? He has been assured that he is the Son of God. Not in Satan's hoped-for way, which is generally the way of the world, looking after number one and our own needs first, but in God's way. In all his answers, Jesus has God in the forefront, and he is obedient to God's will. God's Son is not about power over humanity, but power for humanity in restoring the righteous relationship with God. Now, this is the key to Paul's writing to the Romans. It is often thought that the Jews were not really religious, but according to one commentator that I read, in fact, it was the very opposite. The Israelites were so religious that they thought they deserved salvation purely by their own goodness. They had this massive shift in their understanding of how, that instead of their salvation being through the grace of God, it was now down to their following the laws that Moses received from God. Rather than trusting in the promises of God, if God failed, who knows, he might, then they would still be all right. For Paul, Christ is the fulfillment of the law. The goal of the law was to reconcile people to God, and Jesus is the incarnate demonstration that God had brought this promise to fruition. Christ is the demonstration of God's faithfulness, and the resurrection is the demonstration of God's trustworthiness. Trusting in God is indeed the only way to have a relationship with God. If we only trust in ourselves, we will never have a righteous relationship with our Creator. That is why Paul is so adamant that this relationship with God is open to all, Jews and Gentiles alike, because anyone who comes to faith and believes in God and trusts in him has the same rights and the same love in the eyes of God. As Paul says, whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. No ifs, no buts, no qualifications, such as I'll only save them if they come to church each week, or only if they are clean and don't have any bad habits, or only if they are heterosexual or don't do drugs, and the list can go on. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. So where does your trust lie? When things are going on in your life, at which stage do you call on the name of God? When something arises that may be a temptation, how do you react to it? Just one won't hurt. Or just this once, no one will ever know. But temptations can become identity challenges for us too. Jesus' refusal of his temptations proved that he was an obedient son. Jesus' refusal of his temptations identifies him as a righteous person. How do our temptations identify us? This Lent, I urge us all to seriously try to answer these questions. Who am I and how am I travelling with God? Amen. So let us pray. God, our Creator, help us to see who we truly are this Lent, and help us to deal with our temptations and to be able to journey with you. You are not some distant God, but are deep within us. So guide us into our inner depths to gain that righteous relationship with you. In the name of Christ our Lord. Amen. So together let's stand and say the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. In response to God's word and in light of our affirmation of faith, let us now offer our gifts to God.
Loving God, we give you thanks for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross and was resurrected so that we may have new life. We give you thanks also that in return we may offer these gifts back to you of our time and our worship and our money and this bread and wine. We ask your blessings on them and for the building up of your kingdom in this place. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
It's time for our prayers for the people. Let us pray. Long ago you brought your people out of slavery to freedom. Hear the cries of your people today who are held in bondage by oppression, persecution or war. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
You led your people through the desert to a land flowing with milk and honey. Hear our cries of your people today who are hungry and homeless, for all who daily struggle with life for survival. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
With a mighty hand and outstretched arm, you led your people out of Egypt. Hear the cries of those today who have lost their way, all who wander without direction, purpose or hope, with their in their lives. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
With arms outstretched upon a cross, you brought redemption to your people. Hear the cries of those today who long to hear your message for forgiveness, reconciliation and love. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
You led your Son out into the desert to prepare for his earthly ministry. Hear the prayers for all who seek this Lent to understand their meaning of baptism and equip them to carry your gospel to the broken world. And as we talk about a broken world, we remember the people of Ukraine, the citizens of Russia, and particularly the flood victims in Australia. Lord, in your mercy.
Yeah.
You sent your angels to minister to your Son in the desert. Hear the cries of those today who experience pain, loneliness, despair or grief, all who are in need of your tenderness and care. And today we remember people within our community, Sandra and her Denise Desiree, Elizabeth, Jacqueline and Michael, Ivy, Gus and Ian, Bob, Phil, Marlene, Ian, Donna, Kathy, Jeanette, Barbara, Paul, Chrissy, Brody and Kelsey, as well as Lorraine and June, Clifford, Helen, Pam and Ian, Sione and Jan, Pearlie and Dennis, Ross, Beck, Daniela and Mason, for Jim and Grant, and for Lorraine, a past member of the Dandy Uniting Church, and for all those who are in need of our prayer but have not let their names be known. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And let us finish with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven,
hallowed be your name.
Your kingdom come,
your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread.
Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us.
Save us from the time of trial
and deliver us from evil.
For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Our communion hymn is Eat This Bread, Drink This Cup.
Yep.
To me and never be harmed.
We are the body of Christ.
His Spirit is with us.
Let us lift up our hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right indeed that we should praise you, God of love, our source and our fulfillment. For you create all things, and in you we live and move and have our being. Your wonder is manifest in land and sea and sky. When the times had at last grown full and the earth had ripened in abundance, you made us in your image for yourself. And even though we turn from you again and again, you call us to yourself, and in every age promise liberation. As a mother tenderly gathers her children, you embrace the people as your own, to rear them in your way of compassionate love. From your own being, you sent Jesus among us, incarnate of the Holy Spirit and born of Mary, our sister. Jesus revealed your care for all you have made and showed us your way of reconciliation. Looking forward to the joy of new life, Jesus suffered the pangs of the cross and in rising again became the firstborn of the renewed family. You sent your Holy Spirit and gave birth to us as your church. Your Spirit stays to nurture and to guide us. And now we join hands around your table and with all creation. We hymn your praise for your unending love as we say, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. To you indeed be glory, Almighty God, because on the night before he died, your Son, Jesus Christ, took bread. When he had given you thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. After supper, he took the cup. When he had given you thanks, he gave it to them and said, This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you. Do this as often as you drink it to remember me. And so in this great sacrament, we celebrate and proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ has died.
Christ has risen. Christ will come again
in glory. Therefore, loving God, recalling now Christ's death and resurrection, we ask you to accept this, our sacrifice of praise. As the grain once scattered in the fields and the grapes on the vine are now united on this table in bread and wine, so, Lord, may your church be gathered from the ends of the earth into your kingdom. For yours is the power through Christ for ever and ever. Amen. Come to the table, for all is prepared. The body of Christ broken for us. And the blood of Christ, symbol of the new covenant, shed for us. Let us pray. Jesus, our Lord, we confess that we are sinners, but in your goodness you invite us to approach your holy table and to partake of your heavenly banquet. Trusting in your mercy, we come to you with confidence, albeit with a contrite and humble heart. Lord, we are not worthy that you should enter under our roofs, but say only the word and our souls shall be healed. Come to us, Jesus, come to us, and keep us in your love and your grace forevermore. Amen.
Come now to our time of church notices. Next Sunday, we're back here for worship, live and online, and it's so good to have our online congregation with us for the second Sunday in Lent. On Tuesday night, that's the 8th of March at 7 p.m, we're having church council here. We're looking also for our pastoral care groups and our prayer chain. Now, we have several pastoral care team leaders, and they each have a group of you who we look after pastorally. If you would like to know who your pastoral carer is, if you're unsure, if you come to me, we can let you know who they are. The team leaders are Suzanne, Nada, Jim, myself, and Rhonda. And also, if you would like to join the prayer chain, that's run by Jacqueline. So if there's a problem or something you need prayers about, you ring up Jacqueline or myself, and we will continue your prayers down the chain. It's a wonderful ministry that Jacqueline does. Because of her pains, we don't often see her at church, but she still has this wonderful ministry. And also, out in the foyer before you go, Mary's put together a monthly newsletter which has a roster on it, our groups, and on the back all bits and pieces of what's going on, various prayers. So make sure you grab one of those so that we're hopefully a month ahead and people know what's going on. And that will come out the first week of each month. Okay. So, anybody else? Phil? Phil, sir.
You can go first.
I have some good news to share. I'm going to hold my first Mandela art exhibition. It'll feature over 30 paintings that I've done. So I'm quite excited about being able to do that. It's going to be on Saturday the 2nd of April from 9 to 4 p.m. at the Andrews Centre. Some of you people might know where the Andrews Centre is. It's in Endeavour Hills. There's going to be a free morning and afternoon tea. Entry fee is a gold coin donation. And all the proceeds are going to support the Andrews Centre, which is a voluntary non-profit charitable organisation which seeks to provide for those who are in need. So I hope you can all come along to that and drop by and say good day and have a look at all my artwork. So thanks.
Today's gospel is very, very appropriate in light of what's happening in Ukraine. The devil has a great way of trying to lure people, and sadly the devil, Putin, he has corrupted the leadership of the Orthodox Church into believing, just like Trump did with it. And I ask your prayers for that leadership, that we can all pray to God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, that they will enlighten those leaders and take them out of the rigid historical position that they have put themselves into, which is permitting the slaughter. And what Putin did in Syria, he destroyed the medical facilities, and he's doing the same in the Ukraine. Mm. Now, on Friday night in Ireland, the Irish people donated $5 million Australian to the Irish Red Cross to provide medical services in the Ukraine. But I just please pray to the Holy Trinity and the church leadership, because that's who we need to change. Because people like you, Putin, not even God will change them, I'm sorry to say, because I've met people like them. Thank you.
Okay, we come to our words of mission as and wisdom. Okay, go now, confessing Christ is Lord, in word and deed. Worship and serve the Lord your God and no other. Stand firm in the time of trial. Tell the story of God's goodness and trust in the Lord, whose saving word is always with you.
Thank you for those lovely words of wisdom and mission. Thank you to our online congregation for joining us today. Great to have you with us, and hopefully see you next week. No, something's in there, I forgot. Please stand for the blessing. Oh, that's up. Sorry. We pray for Jeanette, Mary, my best friend, almost sister to Mary. She had a scan recently, and her football-sized tumour she's been carrying around is now like a ping pong ball. So
awesome.
Thank you for your prayers. Lord God, you who breathe the spirit of life within us, draw out of us the light and life you created. Help us to find our way back to you. Help us to use our life to reflect your glory and to serve others as your Son Jesus did. And the blessings of God, the Father, the Son and the Holy Spirit will be with us now and forevermore. Amen. Amen. And our recessional hymn, at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow.
Morning tea,
Rose. Oh, and morning tea, yes. Thank you. That was another thing going around. Morning tea, please join us after.